first, let's welcome Dan and Rich to give us a look at the latest game in the Tomb Raider franchise, Shadow of the Tomb Raider. You guys, the game looks gorgeous. I got to play it a couple of months ago, so good job.
Thank you.
How's the fan reception to it been?
It's been great about the whole thing, so we're very, very proud and happy to see the reaction.
We think it's really exciting because we really look at Shadow of the Tomb Raider as both the end of the trilogy, but also a perfect jumping on point because this is Lara Croft's defining moment. So it's been great to see the fans saying, yes, I can't wait to see how Lara becomes the Tomb Raider. And it's also been great to see a bunch of new people saying, okay, maybe I need to go back and play Tomb Raider and Rise of the Tomb Raider because this is the Maya apocalypse. This is Lara Croft really deciding and becoming the Tomb Raider she's always been destined to be.
That's the thing that interests me in it the most is this is kind of a story, from what I can gather, about Lara almost coming to terms with the fact that she's not perfect, that some of the mistakes that happen in the universe are actually her fault. Can we talk about what that is going to be like for players?
Yeah, the thing that we wanted to do with this game is that we wanted to make sure that when we presented the kind of Lara, it was a Lara that before on Rise and Tomb Raider 2013, she was dealing with the action that was not, the consequence of the action that was not from her.
Yeah.
It was always from other people. And for us to really bring you a more mature Lara Croft, you know, she was getting closer to what she's destined to become, the Tomb Raider. We need to make sure that she understood that there's responsibility of your action. You're just gonna go there and just take an action and without thinking about it. And the whole game for us to say, she needs to reach, you know, the maturity is to understand the consequence. And this is what the whole game is about.
I think that's a really interesting take because, you know, originally when she was introduced, she didn't have that much personality. And then we've known that she's a caring person. She cares about her friends. She built her relationships. But it seems like this time around, it's more about her taking responsibility for who she's becoming. Was that difficult to write?
It was difficult because one of the most difficult emotion to convey is guilt. Because, you know, as an audience, you don't necessarily feel guilt for the action of your protagonist. In this case, it was very, very important from the get-go that we absolutely nail guilt. And that's why when you play the beginning of the game, when she takes the dagger and you see all the consequence that it made, and even the child, you know, the child that you're like, oh, I could save, because normally in previous games, you would be saving the child. In this case, it's happening. And you're like, oh my God, I feel the guilt of what happened.
Yeah.
And I think in addition to guilt, what I really love is it's that balance. There's more inner conflict than we've ever seen in Lara Croft before in terms of the choices, the consequences of her actions. But we also have to make sure that they always have that aspirational quality. That for Lara, she is doing what she feels is right. And yes, she makes a mistake and she triggers the Maya apocalypse. And so she feels compelled to fix things. And along the way, you may question her motives and say, okay, how much is driven by revenge? You'll see Jonah acting as her moral compass. But with that guilt comes self-sacrifice and comes perseverance and comes Lara pushing through the darkest parts of her moments and the darkest moments of her life to become the Tomb Raider. And that means stepping out into the light. So that I think, is a great balance.
I was going to ask about that next. Sorry. This does seem like her darkest story. Yeah, would you guys agree with that?
I would say there's the darkest moments in there. Of course there is. You can see a couple of snippets during the video, the trailer.
Even but, the tomb she's in right now. I think this is the first time that you guys will be seeing this. It looks pretty dark in here, too.
It is dark because the take that we wanted to do with tombs is really going to the terrifying and deadly aspect of it because we want to push that. This is going to be the most Tomb Raider of the Tomb Raiders, okay? The Tomb Raider, previous Tomb Raider. And but there's a lot of also light moments. In the game, one of the questions we ask ourselves the first time was like, if Lara would sit down at a cafe and exchange in making jokes, what would that be? You know, and it was, we were like, oh, we never did that. So what would that be? And then we start having moments like that, much more positive and more feeling about, you know, its humor and it's funny.
You have to have that balance.
Exactly.
Otherwise, the darkness starts to lose its impact.
Exactly.
And so what you need are, you need to have Lara on a roller coaster ride. You need to have her pushing. And you're right, it is the darkest in terms of the story. Oh, he's going to get me.
There's a fly in here.
You have to have those moments where Lara does hit rock bottom, but you also have to show how she climbs back out again. You have to see how she pushes herself, like she always has throughout the series, pushing herself beyond normal physical, human limits, mental, spiritual, emotional limits, to push through those barriers to become what she's meant to be and to do what she thinks is right. And so having that light and darkness balance, but yeah, the dark moments are really dark, we think that's what makes this story really special.
When I wrote my first impressions of playing the game a couple of months ago, I actually said that I thought this was her darkest story yet, and I really liked that about it, but I did have a lot of people ask me, is she still likable? And mm-hmm. I feel like she is, but that's a good follow-up, is how difficult was it to, you know, show a darker side of her, show Jonah calling her a narcissist and yeah. telling her that what she's doing is wrong and she needs to think about everyone else, but still have people feel like she's that same Lara.
And that's the thing. That was a big challenge, because normally when you start and, you know, their hero does something that you wouldn't do, and you'll be like, it's very difficult. But for us, like the Day of the Dead moment was very important. Mm-hmm. You see a Lara that's much more human, having conversation, Jonah, talking about what she likes, the food that she likes, and things like that was really important for us to expose that part of humanity, so that when she does the things that she does, you understand it's her character flaw. Because a human being, it's not just about how strong and quality, the good qualities you have.
Yeah.
It's also the bad qualities and the things, like, for in her case, the obsession.
Yeah.
We've always striven to make Lara one of the most relatable characters possible. We always wanted to show the very grounded, very mature approach to her story. And part of that is doing things that is a little bit risky with her character. But to your point, she always has to feel like she's fighting for what she believes is right. And that, I think, is what keeps her relatable and likable, because she still is a hero. You know, even if she's at some times struggling to not become the monster she's facing, you know, at some times she's saying, okay, I can't live in a world where the ends justify the means. You know, she is walking right up against that line of becoming closer to Trinity, and watching her get close to that darker side, to that shadow side, if you will, and then pulling herself away from it, that's what I think makes the journey so compelling.
Yeah, and I did also want to mention that the game's antagonist is actually kind of a likable guy.
He is a likable guy. When we start writing the story, because when you want a most relatable character like Lara Croft, we wanted to go into much more personal, much more internal. We wanted to have the world being as live as possible, but also when we look at the antagonist, we said, what would be, you know, if she's white, what would be the black side of it? What, when is she's black, how could it be white? And we exchanging that, it became almost like a waltz. And both of them are completing each other, and because of that, you have a Lara Croft that you understand a little bit more, because the other character is also human.
Yeah.
And it's cool to think that villains would be the hero of their own story. He is not some mustache twirling, oh my God, I want to. He is doing what he thinks is right for his culture, uh-huh. and we don't want to spoil too much, but for where he comes from, and he is trying to remake the world in a way that he thinks will be better for humanity. Now, he's doing things that are going to wipe out a lot of human existence.
So is she, though, right?
And that's the whole, that's the push and pull, right? Mm-hmm. That's the conflict, and you saw a little bit of that in the trailer as well that we debuted yesterday. This idea that there is that duality. There are those conflicting and those mirrored sides where he is at times a very relatable villain, where you're saying, I can kind of understand what he's doing. And at times, Lara is skirting that edge of saying, wow, Lara, what's your motives here? Again, Lara will always be the hero and he will always be the villain, but we love having them kind of meet in the middle at key points.
I feel like you guys nailed that. And I could talk about the story forever, but I'm sure everyone at home wants to know about gameplay as well. So one concern that I had is that this is going to feel too similar to previous games. What has changed?
But it's because one of the things that you started with the beginning of the game. Mm-hmm. The beginning of the game is introducing all the things you've learned, all the things, so that feels a little bit similar.
It's tutorial.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah, that makes sense.
Exactly. But what changed a lot is the way we build entire level design has, you know, we had difficulties at the beginning. We were like, oh my God, we have to change the whole way we building the levels for
now
traversal, for example.
Now you can rappel,
Because you can rappel. Because the previous games, you can only ascend. Mm-hmm. And if you were dropping, it's because you were falling. But never, you know, because we didn't want Lara to lose control when she was descending. We want her to be stay in control. So the whole way to approach level design. Also, the environment. Also, when she can basically also, you know, climb on the ceiling of things. So that also opened up. So there's a lot more in the traversal than you've seen before. The same thing with combat, because we try to provide much more control to the player.
Stealth stuff is really cool.
Yeah, but there's much more opportunities, because on Rise we provide a lot more opportunities in assault. We call that assault when you go full gun blazing. In this case, we wanted to make sure that because she's much more experienced and competent, she would become the world, not just being a threat, you know, not just for the enemies, but also becoming that world. Mm-hmm. And that was important for us. A lot more option, a lot more things in terms of the experience. The same way with the tombs, for example, or when you're talking about going underwater. So those, we made sure that this evolution was big for each of our pillars. And exploration, the same way. We never built a hidden city. We never built a city where there was people there in this the way that we did. So we have to rethink how you would be building all these hubs. So now the whole thing for us feels very, it's kind of similar, but also like having this new treatment to the entire thing. So it really feels different in terms of the overall experience when you experience all the pillars.
I think that the thing I like best about it is we're taking Lara, and this is the end of her origin story, so it is the most capable, the most calculating that you've ever seen her before.
I'm totally sold on Lara.
So in order to still provide a challenge, we had to up the ante in every other facet of the gameplay. So to Dan's point, the combat, you have more options, but you also have more challenge. In the traversal, you have more options, but you also have more challenge. The tombs, they're more than ever, they're bigger than ever, but they're darker, they're deadlier, they're scarier than ever before. The hub, the biggest we've ever delivered in a Tomb Raider game.
About next is like, how does that open worlds?
Absolutely.
That looks crazy too.
We have to take you on the roller coaster ride, but every now and then we open it up and let you just experience the world at your own pace and say, hey, you can pause the narrative now. It's the biggest tomb we've ever delivered, or sorry, the biggest hub we've ever delivered in a Tomb Raider game. There's challenge tombs, there's side missions, there's social puzzles, there's people to interact with. There's all this stuff to do. And again, everything is about raising the stakes across the board. And so we think that that's what really will feel different. It should still feel like you're playing a Tomb Raider game.
Exactly.
But it should feel like you are playing with a Lara Croft who has been through a lot and is now really coming into her own. Mm-hmm. And the world is pushing back and the enemies are pushing back even harder than ever to try and stop her from achieving her destiny.
I have to say, I love how passionately and easily you guys are talking about this. And I know everyone's really, really excited about it. And I love this iteration of Lara so much. So thank you for joining us.